सुख साधनम् आयुर्वेदोपदेशेषु विधेः परमादरः। आयुःकामयमानेन धर्मार्थ सुख साधनम् आयुर्वेदोपदेशेषु विधेः सुख साधनम् आयुर्वेदोपदेशेषु विधेः परमादरः।
Dear viewers, Ayurveda, the knowledge of life and longevity, is perhaps the oldest existing body of knowledge on the healing process. It is not merely a medical system, it is a way of life. This knowledge system deals with not only the problems of the body and mind, but also that of the human spirit and consciousness. In these days of changing paradigms, when Western science is looking to Eastern logic and spirituality to find solutions to physical, mental, spiritual, and social problems, it is important for us to rediscover this holistic thought process in the interest of humanity at large. It is our humble attempt through this series to bring Ayurveda and its allied knowledge systems into your homes and hearts. We hope we have your blessings in this purposeful journey of ours.
तद्विद्धि प्रणिपातेन परिप्रश्नेन सेवया उपदेक्ष्यन्ति ते ज्ञानम् ज्ञानिनस्तत्त्वदर्शिनः।
We have a very, very ancient culture. In fact, the root of our culture is so ancient that it's very difficult to even give a time period of when it started. And the entire knowledge, culture, values of our country is presently alive only because of what we call the Guru Shishya Parampara. And from where does this parampara start? It starts from the Lord Himself, Sadashiva Samarambham. And it goes continuously through a chain, an unbroken chain of gurus and shishyas. And it comes right up to us in its purest form because it is unbroken. How did it happen? In the ancient times, in the Gurukula, students used to stay along with the shishyas as you stay right here.
Even in the case of an Indian knowledge system like Ayurveda, in which training ought to have been imparted from teacher to disciple, ideally through traditional methods, Western ways have taken over. In 1899, a Western scholar, MacDonald, had remarked about the process of oral transmission of knowledge in India from guru to shishya thus. I quote, "The Vedas are learnt by heart as they were long before the invasion of Alexander and could be restored from the lips of religious teachers even if every manuscript or printed copy of them were destroyed. unquote. Such a situation as described by MacDonald exists now only as a memory from our distant past. Today in Indian universities, Ayurveda too is taught like any other subject. The Gurukula system of teaching is something that we read about only in books. In ancient India, students went and stayed with teachers to learn from them. Each teacher was an institution unto himself. He taught not for money, but as a labor of love. Not only did the teacher give free tuition, but also provided food and shelter for his pupils. They were members of his family, like his own children. And there were no fixed hours of learning either. Being with the teacher was considered the best way to learn. And thus, in the Indian worldview, education was a kind of personality transference of the guru to the shishya. Guru, or the master, passed on not just information, but real knowledge, along with the ethics and value systems attached to such knowledge.
Guru in our tradition is a person who has reached the lakshya. The Guru Paduka Puja, we have a concept that we worship the feet of the Guru. What is the feet of the Guru? It is the feet that is not moving. The feet that does not move is the feet that has reached the destination. So the platform on which the Guru stands is saturated.
Tadvidhi pranipadayana pariprasnayana sevaya. So it is not only asking questions and getting clarification, but pariprasnayana, you have to ask question over the question so that you becoming a critic of the answer. And it has to be done from a state of humbleness, sevaya. You have to be below to receive knowledge, like water flows from upper stream to the lower stream. Knowledge has to come from that kind of situation. And Ayurveda has given special importance to this relationship between Guru and Shishya. And Ayurveda is a science which has been orally transmitted from generation after generation. It is only in the Samhita period Ayurveda got into written tradition at the time of Charaka Samhita.
The Gurukula tradition is an oral tradition. During the days when I was studying with my Guruji, the great Pumuli Nambudiripar, I used to sit with him every day for several hours with a book in my hand. I used to chant, I used to read the book, and he used to explain without having any book in the hand. So, this is called Shravanam. Shravanam means hearing. You are not supposed to hear everything. You are supposed to hear what is good or what gives ulkarsha in your life.
Any education system, you need to have a cultural setup, the socio-cultural setup. So if you try to interpret the socio-cultural setup that is available today, how much the Guru Shishya Parampara is really possible to implement? Let us ask that question. One-to-one type of relationship, when your needs are so high. I'm told that we have 170 colleges, 170 colleges in this country. And if I take 50 years per, then we are producing 6,500 Ayurvedic physicians per year. It means that I should have as many teachers. And what is going to be the socio-economic model to support this education system? So it's impractical. But on the other hand, what we need to do is, somewhere we need to create, to pick up the principles of Guru Shishya Parampara. What were the strengths of this system? What were the advantages of this system? Why Guru Shishya Parampara was more conducive to the Ayurvedic knowledge? Because it is the knowledge which was imparted, which is applied from Guru to Shishya on individuals. So there is a knowledge and there is an application.
Guru Shishya Parampara, I think, is more a concept which is coming out of all our, I think, maybe epics and, you know, I mean, the life of Krishna and such things. But I do not know how much of that we know in terms of, you know, interactive discipline. Now, what I am saying is that, is it necessary to have only one guru? if you look at Dattatreya's concept, that he had 24 gurus, and he learned from, you know, from a human being, or from even a serpent, and a bird, and a dog. So if that is a concept of guru, I have nothing against that. You should have enough gurus to make you wise in many things. Because one guru and one discipline is successful only if the guru himself is, you know, a person with broad thinking. But if guru says, no, what I am telling you is the truth, nothing else is the truth, then I think it's not going to work out.
Why guru shishya parampara is necessary? Let us ask this question. We are going away from Sanskrit. We are going away from ancient texts. The new Ayurvedic graduates are going away from the fundamentals of Ayurveda because of the new model which we have. Now, if we want to re-establish that link with the knowledge, the Sanskrit text knowledge, the knowledge base, the proper interpretation, we need to have that kind of a bunch of teachers who are only dedicated to these purposes. And then this education could be imparted in groups by different modules. We need to have a contemporary model to satisfy those needs.
After the degree is being awarded, these students should be sent to masters who may not be professors as prescribed by a university. Today, university insists that the teacher should not be more than 58 years old, but there are much older vaidyas with enormous amount of experience, wisdom, which is lying untapped. These people should happen. And such an experiment was suggested when the university was started in Chitrakoot by the great Nanaji Deshmukh, where we have suggested that don't go for a formal institution, but try to have gurus selected in various parts of the country. Send these people to them for training and give them financial support to the teacher and the taught. And make sure that these knowledges are transferred to the younger generation before the great masters disappear from this world.
Considering the holistic growth of the student, the Gurukula system has a great advantage. There is no doubt about it. For in the Gurukula system, the students and teachers get to know each other very well. So it doesn't become a focus on just one aspect of the student. There is understanding of, as we say, the five sheets of the personality. In our ancient literature, human personality has been described as being on annamaya, pranamaya, manomaya, vijnanamaya, and anandamaya levels. Food sheath, vital air sheath, mental sheath, intellectual sheath, and bliss sheath. So this whole personality is better understood when the teachers and students are living together. So many opportunities life throws before them, and that makes for a really much better development of the student. So Gurukula system is better not only for various branches of Indian knowledge, but for any knowledge in general.
When the student goes to the teacher, the student is asked to question and go into the depth of its understanding. And depending on the type of questions the student asks, the teacher will judge the level of the student, because the subtlety of the question shows how intelligent the student is. For example, all of us have seen the apple falling down, but it was given to Newton to ask why should the apple fall down. Even today it appears, oh, it became ripe, therefore it fell down. All right, when it becomes ripe, why should it fall down? Why not go up? Why not go to the front? Why not go to the back? This is the subtlety of the question. When such questions are asked, the teachers immediately feel very happy.
When we see the teachings of the Upanishad, we have the gurus being extremely frank. In Taittiriya Upanishad, they say, please take whatever good you saw in us and please drop whatever was otherwise. That is very humble of the teachers to say in that very famous convocation address in Shikshavalli of Taittiriya Upanishad of Yajurveda. So, the transference of good qualities takes place for very wonderful imprint is made on the mind. We always believe that examples teach better than volumes and volumes of mere words. Therefore, the teacher's management of different ticklish situations in the Gurukul teach the students more effectively.
In Prashnopanishad, it says, Ati prashnan prachasi, brahmishtosi, tasmatehim bravimi. The teacher appreciates the student. Because student asks a very fundamental question, kuta esha prano jayate, kathamayatyasmin sharire. How did this prana come into being? Is there something beyond the prana? Or is prana the final? And when such questions are asked, teachers are very happy. And the tradition also says that if supposing the teacher doesn't know the answer, what is the spirit? He will not snub the student and throw him off.
When the students serve the teacher, in today's language itself, we may say, there is a better emotional support that they derive for themselves. For in human life, emotions play a very major role. And service, rather than making one merely subservient, connects one better with other people. In other words, life is give and take. Today, this student serves his teacher. Tomorrow, someone else serves this person himself. So it is give and take, but in the process, the emotional well-being of everybody is ensured.
And there is ample opportunity for interactions and this. Pariprashna. Pariprashna has been the speciality. And this has been the scientific tradition. In the scientific tradition also, we see that a person is asked to go through experimentation. Do the experiment and examine and observe very keenly with subtlety. And then only you can unravel the mysteries. So it is not mere blind faith. Upanishads and our entire tradition promotes this type of scientific inquiry. Experimentation, not only the Shravana, Manana, the Nididhyasana, experiment, the inner laboratory, one has to experiment.
After Shravana is Manana. You have to think it. You have to rethink and think and think. Then you get your own ideas. You start developing the Shastra in your way.
Shravana is hearing, hearing from the teacher, then through interactions and questions, then he starts cogitating. That is Manana. And then once he logically feels yes, it may be okay, then he starts the experimentation called the Nididhyasana. Nididhyasana is an experiment that he is going to do in his inner laboratory. In the science, we went into the external lab, biochemical lab, neurology lab, and immunology lab, several other things, and investigated. But here it is the internal lab. Internal lab is inside our mind. And you start examining from where the whole universe has come. For example, Taittiriya Upanishad, the student asks, I want to know about Brahman. And the teacher doesn't answer, Brahman is so and so. Why you want to know about Brahman? Go and find out. Tapasa brahma vijignasasva tapo brahmeti, he said. Go and do tapas, that's experimentation. Then how to do the experiment? Then he gives a hint. Yato va imani bhutani jayante yena jatani jivanti yat prajanti abhisamvishanti te tadvijignasasva, he said. Find out from where something is getting created, and it's the same principle which sustains. It is under the same principle, the whole thing goes back. Srishti Sthiti Laya, from where it occurs. Find out that principle.
Ayurveda itself, the text itself, gives some guidelines. Like there are three or four stages. The first thing that Charak Samhita says is Swatma Pariksha. Before embarking upon the study of a science, you have to assess yourself. What are you? Are you fit to study this science? What are your interests? The second thing is called a Shastra Pariksha. That is which branch of medicine or learning what you want to study. Third thing is called as Guru Pariksha. You have to find out a proper person from whom you can learn this. And alternatively, there is also a Shishya Pariksha. The Guru also tests the Shishya. So what we say is in all our traditional scriptures, there is what we call as the coming together of the subject, the listener and the speaker. The right person handing the information, right information, to the right individual. That is what we call as education.
आयुषो वेदम प्रजापति मजीकृहत ब्रह्मा स्मृत्वायुषो वेदम प्रजापति मजीकृहत सोऽश्विनो तौ सहस्राक्षं सोऽत्रिपुत्रादिकान् मुनि ते यज्ञनिवेशादिकां ते तु पृथक् चन्द्राणि ते निरे ते यज्ञनिवेशादिकां ते तु पृथक् चन्द्राणि ते
प्रजापति मजीग्रहम् प्रजापति मजीग्रहम्।